views and hold governments to account. It's £130 million, 37 large programs, working in 100 countries with 1,000 civil society organizations. It's probably, well, it is DFID's biggest initiative on governance and civil society, and probably the biggest initiative on governance alone. And we should be using this. We should be using this for the real long-term impact, the lessons that are coming out. I mean, the work, it covers virtually everything. I mean, it covers all the different forms of civil society, from faith groups to trade unions to cooperatives. It's working on all the different areas, from anti-corruption, water and sanitation. Huge. There's a huge body of knowledge that should be coming out of the Governance and Transparency Fund. We've recognised that, and we have been trying to do that, and these seminars are part of that process. But we've recognised that we need to do a lot more. And recently, you know, over the last few months, we've actually been providing more resources for the fund managers to actually focus and strengthen this whole area of impact and lesson learning. And this is going to be led by Steve Bertram and Aileen Lyons. They're going to be working on this, and they've developed a draft impact and learning strategy, which I think is extremely exciting. So we're interested in this, both from the individual programs and projects, as well as the funders as a whole. I mean, on the projects, there's always been a focus on identifying how there is going to be long-term sustainability. And over the years of the Governance and Transparency Fund, this has been growing, and there's been a much greater analysis and understanding of the long-term sustainability of these programs. That has just been illustrated today from WaterAid. I mean, there's much more work going on that. But also, we're really interested in the lessons learned from the individual programs, you know, building up rigorous evidence of what approaches work and what approaches don't work. I mean, again, over the years, there's been the rigor of the evidence, the rigor of the collection of the information has been growing dramatically within the Governance and Transparency Fund's individual programs. And then, as I was saying, we're very interested in the fund as a whole. And Steve and Aileen have been working on that, and they've been developing this overall kind of impact and learning strategy. And this learning strategy is going to kind of be focusing on articulating the major results from the different programs, trying to contribute to the body of governance knowledge at a global level, but also at context-specific knowledge, and building the capacity of partners organizations to embed the whole process within the organizations. To achieve this, they're looking at articulating the big results, pulling out the big results from across the whole fund, not just the kind of specific outputs where, you know, it's the direct result of the individual organizations, but where it's really changed something. And, well, an example that they use is the WaterAid work in India, you know, Graham Vikas, advocating for change, that change resulting in changes in policy, and there's 40 to 60% increase in government spending on specific services. So it's that sort of big result that they're going to be pulling out and getting a whole series of them from across the overall fund. And then when they've identified those different big results, they're going to be analyzing them against a whole series of parameters, be it the quality of evidence. And they're going to tie this in with the bond evidence principles, which I hope people know about, because they're a very exciting way of kind of really looking at the quality of evidence. But also trying to really clarify what the theory of change is for all of these different results. You know, the context, the long-term problem, who's benefiting, the process, the assumptions. And so having the quality of evidence, the theory of change, looking at the different approaches, tools and methods, how it's actually done, looking at the impact, obviously, and also value for money where possible. With all of that information, looking at the different parameters, there is going to be a need to be a process of verifying and deepening the understanding of the lessons. And this can be done through a variety of mechanisms, be it seminars such as these, the final evaluations of the different programs, and verification country visits if necessary. And what we're hoping to come out of this is a body of knowledge that is useful both for DFID, DFID when we're setting up programs on governance, which we're doing all the time all around the world, but also other development actors, be the civil society, other governments, other donors. And so a big, large body of information, and from that body of information, we will be producing, longer reports and more specific briefing reports, 4 or 5 page long. And this will be on a whole series of ways of looking at the cake. It can be looking at it from a thematic area, impact on services, changes in policy. It can be by looking at the parameters that I was talking about, the theories of change, what we've learned on the theories of change, the value for money, the other ones. And also, there can be other ways we could look at it. Approaches to supporting civil society, how to measure results, what works in capacity building. So there's a whole different way. We'll have the body of information that we'll be looking at this, producing information which we hope will be of use to a whole range of people, because this is a colossal resource that we should be using more effectively. I'm pretty sure Steve and Aileen have been already talking to most GTF fund holders, but I hope there's going to be much more discussion on this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mike, and it sounds like quite a job capitalising the lessons from such a large number of organisations and over a significant period of time. And I think the investment that DFID has put in over the years is really important, because, as you say, it probably amounts to one of the biggest initiatives globally to improve governance. We've got about 10, 15 minutes left, and so I thought I'd open it back up again. What I quite like here is to shift the focus a little bit away from war trade itself and to you. And there are two things that I think it'd be useful for us to do. One is to reflect based on your own experience, your own organisation experience, on this question of sustainability. And the other one is any specific suggestions that you may have for Mike, but also other GTF grant holders, on how we might go about capitalising some of these lessons from the experience. So any thoughts, suggestions? Are there any other GTF grant holders in the room? Who have we got? Which other organisations do we have?
ODI.
Christian Aid is here.
Christian Aid. Wildlife
Conservation Society.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question just to get me going?
Please.
I just had one thing that struck me, and I know this is when you're giving the sort of presentation that you have to explain something very complicated in 10 minutes. It doesn't always, But you were talking about looking at the big results. And when you were talking about that, you mentioned Gram Vikas in India, and that their interventions and, actually getting yourself onto a national committee in India is quite difficult compared with in Uganda or something. They actually got themselves on, and they were there, and they made an impressive contribution from time to time, and then they were very influential as a result. And as a result, there were all these increases in spending and changes in policy. And there were, there's more money in the sector. And that was going to be one of the sort of big results. And it just, I just wonder where that is, this is where, Pache, to you, I think, because there you're saying there's no contradiction between governance and the services. Actually, one needs the other, which I firmly believe. But if the measurements are all about, did you do anything that resulted in more toilets? Or then, if it's focused only on more money was available, or more wells were dug, or more health centres were open, then doesn't that miss some of the key importance of governance?
It wasn't big in the number of beneficiaries. he was big in that he was, the impact was at the kind of outcome level. It wasn't just that the organization had delivered whatever. It was that the organization had resulted in a change that was bringing about real change to people. So it wasn't big in numbers.
What I mean is, is it not considered that there is a big change and real change for people if they live in a society where they are able to critically dialogue with their government on a regular basis, rather than that they got some wells out of it?
Well, yes, I think that would be the case. I think that would be covered. Yeah. That would be regarded as a big result.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Awesome, hands.
Big was the wrong.
It's worked. Okay. Lady at the back, and then I think it's Charles.
I totally support all of those. On the cross-cutting, I should have mentioned the cross. I totally forgot about it. The GTF is one program amongst many that we work on. The Global Poverty Action Fund is actually the central funding mechanism now for the future for civil society in the UK. We do have the program partnership arrangements, and on both of those, there are learning programs. And we are tying those in with the GTF one, so absolutely clear. I should have mentioned that. I totally forgot. And yes, on the overarching framework, the original Governance and Transparency Fund did not have an overarching framework, and we back-engineered it. And we have clearly recognized that is very much an ineffective way of working. And it was a severe limitation of the original design. And we've made that as a clear recommendation across DFID already, that if you're doing something like this, you do have to have a clear overarching framework, results framework, theory of change, understanding of the whole thing, and none of those were there.
There's a question, Charles, in the middle.
I'm Charles Beer, work at Beer. So we are not a GTF grant holder. We do governance work under SGA. I guess one thing to comment on is when I was in Zambia recently, there's a lot of decentralization going on there, and we're working with ABCs, and water is one of the many issues that comes up. It's lighting, it's roads, it's health posts, it's all sorts of things. And the mapping that they talked about is a big issue there, and it's raising a lot of activity and a lot of expectations. If it has funding through the CFDA in Zambia, a lot of capacity building work, and we've been capacity builders as well. So that's really good, it's all getting there, but the question is what's next? You know, what, how do we keep it going? There's not much point in trying to measure long-term sustainability if we're not going to be able to fund our activities, if people are just going to go away and think what we do now. So that's a big issue. If the government also don't take it on and incorporate it into their strategy, I think that's a big issue too. And in Zambia, again, for example, they see it they view with suspicion ADCs because it's a political issue. So we're getting into politics and some murky water here. So two big issues. How do you just keep the thing going anyway? And how do you win that institutional support? I don't know the answers.
Well, very disappointing.
and the gentleman behind her.
Just sort of picking up on that, the kind of perennial issue about timescales, which I have a bit of sympathy for working for an NGO, but at the same time, I sort of think, you know, if it were the case that we were operating on, let's say, 10-year project timescales, would there be the case that we'd suddenly have all the answers in the palm of our hands? You know, do we think, given 10 years, we would be able to show the results? And I kind of think the answer to that would be no. It would either still be not long enough, or it would be too long, or there'd be some thing that would make 10 years not the right number again, or it's not. And I think it's what I'm sort of getting at is this, slightly sort of bought into Owen Barder's point about development not being a thing that you work on, development actually a result of systems working better together. And when you look at it that way, actually, the control that we have over what we're doing sort of evaporates, and we have to say, let's just look at the systemic changes that are happening and how we're managing them. And that way, the timescale thing becomes slightly irrelevant an issue. And I wonder whether we're actually sort of focused on the timescale thing, or are forced to focus on the timescale thing, because we're forced to look at our results, because we're asked to say, you are doing X, Y, and Z, tell us what it will do, tell us how it will be sustained. And this is, you know, this is the debate that we're all having all the time. So whether there's another way to sort of come at this rather than.
Very good. Yes, I remember in the early discussions of the GTF programme here, we had a discussion about, you know, what the different partners would like to work on. And there's some very ambitious ideas put on the table, such as, you know, well, we, you know, want a new ministry. You know, we want to reform the regulatory system for water sanitation services. And pointed out that, you know, firstly, trying to projectise that, and secondly, trying to do it within a five-year programme is rather ambitious. And I think that's important. But the other thing that is worth bearing in mind here is that there are some things which you can make quite a lot of progress on your own or in partnership with a small number of others, particularly at a local government or a community level. But there are other things where you're very, very heavily dependent on government, in particular national government, but also external support agencies, to make any progress at all. And one of the points, I suppose, for DFID to take away is that, you know, if you want agencies to be willing to take the risks, to take on the big challenges, and to really make a difference, then they need that flexibility, not just in terms of the time frame, but also in terms of the log frame. In order to be able to carry it through to its conclusion. And if these things are too tightly constrained, then of course people will go for the low-hanging fruit, but probably less likely to bring about those real sort of big fundamental systemic changes. We're just running out of time. Do you want one last question in the middle?
I was largely going to build on what Lydia had talked about, and what you just mentioned. Being very complimentary about Mike's points, because it was about exploratory learning rather than and feeling our way through what can be done better, not in a completely discursive way, but really picking those lessons. But the problem is, and you mentioned the log frame there, when you come to develop a business case for £100 billion fund and you present it to the Secretary of State and she wants to know what the quantitative indicators are, and you're left with a stuff that's going to be really useful to pass muster. It was almost a sympathy vote from you. I mean, what sort of thinking have you been able to do on how you get quantification without racing to the low-hanging fruit?
I mean, there's a huge amount of work going on. So there's whole teams looking at hard-to-measure results, looking at standard indicators, looking at, I mean, there's...
I had one, just as an example, on a civil society organisation development programme, strengthening programme, in a country not to be specified, one of the indicators was the number of policy changes attributable to the programme.
I've seen that.
Big, small, near, far. I can pick low-hanging fruit like that.
Yeah.
Very cheaply.
Yeah, very, very, very valid questions.
Okay, we're gradually running out of time. I'm just going to give a last opportunity for comments from the panel. Hilary, any last thoughts on the basis of this discussion? What do you take away for your write-up of how we go forward and
how to achieve sustainability in the next 6 months? This is a very interesting discussion, actually, and I'm sort of relieved to find that some people are thinking, you know, have some of the same problems and issues that need to be resolved. And I honestly believe that you need to look at sustainability of governance in the same way as you look at the sustainability of wash services, and that is a systems approach. And you need to have the whole thing. It's not just I can make this sustainable. I can say, well, this village has its own fundraising and it can run its community group forever and ever and ever. Therefore, governance is sustainable. You know, it's not like that. You need to have that whole big picture. I think what I'm taking away from this is the need for better linkages, at least at a national level, between all the various components that need to be put together. And that I see as being they're not terribly strong. You know, the development partners have their own groups and they sit there and they're here and the NGOs over here, the politicians are over there, somehow or another, and the press are there. We do have good involvement with the press in this programme, actually, but we need to have something that works together. And we need to be able to say to people why it matters. Why is this important? You trying to meet your MDGs, we're saying to you, for the moment, put your MDGs over here. We want something else. And that is really what we need to be able to conceptualise and promote as a good in itself.
Okay, thanks. Papa, any thoughts on the basis of the discussion?
Yeah, I mean, I'm more thinking about the next 6 months as well and the post September, really. And I don't have an answer yet, so that's a big question mark. But I'm quite happy to see that we are, many of us, we grappling with this. And I think it's an opportunity to use the different forums where we are on the PPA learning groups, the bond groups, you know, to kind of carry on this kind of discussion. And I do agree with Hilary as well. I mean, we'll be using the kind of 4 C's framework, always framework in development. You know, consultation with government, collaboration with government. If it doesn't work, then confrontation with government, but you never succeed with confrontation. And then you need to compromise. So we're operating within that framework, but definitely all the actors must work together in order to make a change and get to sustainable changes.
Good. Mike, any last thoughts before we keep this quite interesting dialogue going on capitalising the lessons in this area?
Well, it's clear there's so much knowledge that is there within the overall fund and within the overall programmes. And the challenge is to pull it together, pull out the lessons learned. I mean, and activities like today are one way of doing it, but we need to do so much more within the governance and transparency fund.
Okay, very good. Just remains for me to thank the panel for their presentations and thank you for coming along and for contributing to the discussion. I hope you found it interesting. And yes, look forward to seeing you again and continuing this discussion over the next 6-12 months or whatever remains of these programs. Thank you very much.
Thank you.